Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Hayes Worldwide Careers Advice Podcast. Due to coronavirus, this podcast has been recorded remotely. We therefore apologize in advance for any issues in relation to sound or audio quality. Nonetheless, we hope you enjoy the episode and thank you for listening. Welcome to the Hayes Worldwide Careers Advice Podcast, bringing you insights into the world of work. In this series, I'll be talking to experts to give you practical tips and advice on careers. I'm your host, John Beasley from Hayes, the world's largest specialist recruiter. In these difficult times, most interviews are being conducted remotely, either over the phone or by video call. So today, we're joined by Gail Blake, Director of Permanent Employment at Hayes UK in Ireland. Gail is here to share her expert advice for those who are worried about interviewing remotely, in order to help them overcome their fears and secure their next job. Before we begin, it would be great if you could introduce yourself to our listeners.
So I'm Gail Blake. I've been with Hayes for 20 years. I joined Hayes straight after university, mostly working with UK and Ireland business in the construction and property industry. And then I widened it to all specialisms around 2 years ago when I took this job as the UK and Ireland Perm Director. So thanks. Thanks for having me today.
Fantastic. Well, we're really, really pleased to have you on the show. Really interested to get your insights around remote interviews.
Yeah.
Obviously, these are challenging times, and then many people will be feeling unsettled and perhaps anxious at the prospect of an interview that's likely to heighten these feelings. So for those who have never done interviews remotely and especially nervous about doing so, could you provide a brief overview of what they could expect?
Yeah, I mean, I think when we look back on this, actually, at this moment in time, I think we're going to see that it was massive workplace change occurred during this moment. You know, sociologically, we'll probably look back on it and say there was more change in the workplace than there has been possibly since you know, the last 70 years of the Second World War, etc. So I think it's normal, completely normal, for people when we're adapting to these new environments to find that a little bit unsettling, particularly if you haven't looked for work for quite some time. You know, that you wouldn't know to expect this. You know, unless you've looked for work in the last 6 weeks, the chances are you won't be used to doing an interview remotely. So I think, first of all, it's really normal to feel that way. I think the way to visualize it yourself is just a lot of us at the moment are using video conferencing a lot more. And then that's to replace that face-to-face interaction. So all you've got to think of is you're still going to have the interview. And most of us have been on interviews, some form of interview before. So the way in which the interview will be conducted, in the sense of they'll ask you some questions to get to know you better, you will consider that and answer the best way that you can. You know, none of that has actually changed. They still want you to do the best that you can and get to know you the best they can. So actually what they're trying to get out of this hasn't changed. And what you want to get out of this as a candidate hasn't changed. You want to know, what are they like as an employer? What's the culture like? What are these people like that I might be working with? So what you want to expect from it and what they expect from it hasn't changed. So I guess all you need to think about is, in reframe it in your mind, is all that's changed is the way we're doing it. The interview itself, you know, what we're both trying to get out of it has not changed. The way we're conducting it because of the situation we're in has meant that, yes, we're going to have to do this over video rather than face to face. But I think when you're sort of trying to think and prepare yourself for it, don't really think about it in any other way than you would a normal interview. Just like when you're having a chat with your friends and family now, you're doing it over video conference rather than face to face. It's just the same thing has happened.
That's a fantastic point as well, that, you know, the people interviewing you, they want it to go well as well. They want you to be the person, for the right person for the job. Yeah. And that is important to remember, whether it's a video interview or a normal interview as well. I think, you know, we've touched on, and due to the current circumstances, that anxiety is high at the moment and could be adding to interview nerves. And you even said yourself there that, you know, feeling nervous before an interview, it is only natural and it is very common. So would you say that a degree of nerves before an interview is actually beneficial to performance? Because I do hear people saying that. Would you agree?
I think for me, I always think that nerves and excitement are two sides of the same coin. And I think sometimes it's very difficult to separate what is nerves and what is excitement. I think either way, what you're doing is your body is reacting very normally to the situation that it's in. And so, you know, it's going to pump you full of more adrenaline. And therefore, it is normal to feel slightly different. And it shows, I think, how much you care actually about this situation. And your body is just reacting normally to a situation where it feels it's of some importance to you. Now, you can frame that in your head as nerves. I like to frame it in my head as excitement. But all it is your body responding to, this is something that actually I care about. And so I try and take sort of quite a positive view to it. And I think that, yes, absolutely, it can embrace it as actually your body trying to help you. That's why it's doing it. So I kind of relax into it, to be honest.
Do you have any advice to help our listeners manage their current anxieties and get into the right frame of mind to limit their nerves prior to their telephone or video interview?
I've done yoga for 13 years, so I'm always going to come at it from a very mindful sort of place when I think about anxieties, etc. I also I'm very interested in this whole area of getting yourself into the right mindset. And I think preparation is, for me, one of the most important things, because when your brain is under moments of excitement, stress, nerves, whatever words you want to think of, actually, it will then go, the more you've prepared for it, the more, even when you're feeling slightly nervous, you know, in the back of your mind, you've done everything you can to put yourself in the best place. So to me, I think that actually overthinking it doesn't help, but preparing really does help. And I know for me, whenever I've got really important presentations, for example, to do, which I do often, for me, it's all about the preparation for it. And one of the things that I do is to very much practice as often as I can with people who will give you really honest feedback. Now, I've got a few people in my life, and I'm sure you do as well, that will give you really honest feedback. And sometimes, you know, you love them for it. They annoy you sometimes, but they give you that really honest feedback. So I think the more that you can prepare and practice, the more it will almost become second nature for you to be answering these questions. So that when you are then in an interview situation, you know, your brain is almost recalling quite easily what you prepared before. And obviously your friends and the people you're close to, who you trust, would give you honest feedback about how you're coming across. There is also a point, though, and I do this with all my important presentations and interviews, is there's a point where you need to stop preparing. And I think that comes in, maybe just give yourself an hour or so before, when actually you don't. Where you don't look at your notes, or you don't think about it. And this is a moment just to prepare yourself ready. I mean, I personally drink chamomile tea. I sort of stay away from any sort of stimulants, whether it be caffeine, sugar, etc. And I just try and get myself into a really good spot, in the sense of I do yoga. So I do practice my breathing in, you know, in for four, out for four. And I try and regulate my breathing so that I feel as calm as I can be in obviously a situation that's really exciting. But I just think it's about just trying to clear your mind and knowing to prepare, but also knowing when to stop.
Fantastic. Thank you for those insights. They're really helpful. And when you were talking there, it was just thinking about, you know, how I'd usually prepare for an interview. You know, part of that process is obviously deciding what you're going to wear. You know, for me, for instance, it might be a suit. But how do we go about that? You know, if it's, a telephone, you know, interview is one thing, but a video interview, presumably you go through the same process of, you know, planning down to that level as well.
Yeah, totally. And I think don't we all almost have this sort of, you know, costume in some ways, you know, our work the what we wear to work is almost part of our costume that we put on, and that's part of us becoming our work persona. And so absolutely, as part of your interview, what you want to do is, as much as you can, get yourself into that work zone. And I think the way we dress, the way we prepare is really important to that, because it shows a lot about how seriously we're taking this interview. Even if you are sitting at home, you don't want to be there in your home gear. You definitely want to be coming across with your work persona on. I think clearing your desk, you know, to me, I always will, you know, before, even if it's a virtual meeting, you know, like today with you, I still, you know, put on my lipstick and sprayed my perfume. Not that you're going to be able to see that, but I think it's just about getting yourself. That's what I would do if I was in the office. And I think it's just getting yourself into the whatever work, your kind of your work persona, making sure your desk is clear, you know, making sure, you know, for example, I've got children, that they're out of the way, that, you know, you've tested, for example, all your technology. I did that before our conversation today. So it was one less thing for me to worry about. You know, I made sure that the children were off the Wi-Fi, so the router worked really, really well. So it's just one less thing, I guess, for me to worry about, because then I can really concentrate on listening to you. And in some ways, again, this is not an interview, as in it's not a work interview, but you are interviewing me, if that makes sense. So it's about as close as it would be. And like I said before, if it's going to be a video interview, I think do look at your body language, you know, do be aware of that, because actually a video is brilliant from that point of view. You can come across with your true personality, but maybe just get, you know, one of your people in your close friendship circle to give you, or colleagues to give you a bit of feedback on how you're coming across. That might be helpful.
That's great advice. So thanks for that, Gail. You know, if we are nervous, you know, the day before an interview, then understandably getting a good night's sleep might be difficult. According to Forbes, disturbed sleeping patterns are, as a result of the coronavirus pandemic, are impacting the health and quality of life for around 45% of the population globally at the moment. Do you have any advice for our listeners to help them, you know, perhaps get a good night's sleep? You've spoken about tips on how to deal with anxiety, but is there anything else that you can provide us with?
I was talking earlier about I'm really interested in the mindset of fear almost, and preparation and excitement. And one of my favorite films to watch about getting yourself in a good mindset is a film called Free Solo, by a guy called Alex Honnold, who climbs El Cap, which is this big mountain with no ropes or anything. And he talks about, you know, preparation and getting yourself in a really good mindset, but also knowing when to switch off. And to me, it's the balance. I mean, I've been doing yoga for 13 years, so I really believe in balance. And I think you prepare, like Alex Honnold, before he went up that mountain, of course, he practiced and practiced and practiced and practiced. And before I do important interviews or I do important presentations, I practice and practice. I really, really do. And any of the people that work closely with me will tell you that. However, I know when to stop. And I would absolutely say, you know, a good 2 or 3 hours before you go to bed, your brain won't take any more information at a certain point. So just, do you know what? This is just about putting yourself in the best mindset. So I would literally then have, you know, some fun, whatever you view as fun. So, you know, to me, you know, at the moment it's obviously more challenging because we can't go out as much as before. But to me, even just walking around the garden and just taking some fresh air, or, you know, to me, it's just about, you know, just calming your mind down, you know, a warm bath, or actually, you know, you can really lose yourself in a really good book. And I think there's a point where you go, do you know, I'm not helping myself anymore. The best thing I can now do is to just, you know, relax and, you know, switch off all your, you know, your electronics. And that can maybe will just help you get in the, I don't know, the best space you can to sleep.
So on the day of the remote interview itself, some listeners might be feeling understandably worried that it's going to be difficult to build up a rapport with the interviewer. The interview is taking place remotely. Do you have any advice to share with them around that point?
This is something that people can struggle with, whether it's face-to-face or remotely, actually. And the biggest piece of advice I would give is around preparation. So, you know, the beauty of things like LinkedIn, the more that you can read up about them, the more that you can maybe spot some common ground. you know, often in people's LinkedIn profiles, they don't just, they can put, for example, which university they studied at and which, you know, what courses they did. And straight away, that might be some common ground that you might have, in that you might not have studied there, but you might have friends who've done the same thing. To me, it's about preparation of researching the person or the people, if it's a panel, that are going to be interviewing you.
I suppose, you know, with video interview, if there's a bit of a lag, there's always the risk of talking over your interviewer, which is something that you don't want to happen. Is there any way that you can avoid doing that? I personally can't think of how you would. So how would you handle that, I guess?
I think humour. I think, you know, we're all in that boat and it's happening on all calls. And so I think laughing and humour actually is good anyway. But I think leaving a pause when you stopped speaking to give people time to come back, I think using pauses, I have to learn to this because I'm such a chatterbox. But yeah, I've learned to use pauses more when I finished to allow people time to, and giving them time after they finish speaking before I sort of jump in. That's the only way I've thought of. I don't know, probably are better ways, but that's what I've come up with.
No, I think that is a great piece of advice. You know, it's for people, you know, like myself, who don't do this that often. You know, it is a really important consideration. Now, just jumping back a few questions, you mentioned that in preparation for this particular podcast recording that you made sure that you're the only one on the Wi-Fi.
Yes. Do
you have any other technical considerations, you know, that people should keep in mind to make sure that the interview starts well and, you know, in turn will calm, the nerves potentially?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, it's also just like the really practical side of stuff. And I think it's things like just make sure that if you're using, because some people put it on their phone and some people have it on their laptops or their PCs. And I think, you know, it's making sure you've got enough charge. I think that's really important. I think the other thing is that, I don't know about you, but I'm better on certain video conferencing. I'm just really able in some. I mean, I'd give myself like, you know, 10 out of 10, and others I'm quite poor. So I think it's knowing which one they're going to be using. And if you feel like you're not as familiar, is really spending time to learn it. Those people, maybe those colleagues you feel quite close to, who you don't feel embarrassed making mistakes in front of, and know that they'll just laugh it off with you, that maybe they're the people you can practice a little bit with. The other thing, just like closing down other applications, you know, before I started this call with you, I put both my phones on mute. So even if they went off, I wouldn't distract me. But I also think that you know, even if you're very familiar with certain video conferencing facilities, even sometimes they have issues. So I think just turning up early, you know, and even if you're, I'd much rather be 10 minutes early than 1 minute late, because it would actually throw me. So I think turning up early, even if the person you're with doesn't turn up till, you know, 1 minute before the interview, I do think it's good manners.
Yes, I think, yeah, good point, definitely. And we're getting towards the end now, but one thing that I've thought about, and I suppose this question can apply to normal interviews as well as video interviews, you know, once we get back to that point, the prospect of being faced with a panel interview is quite daunting. So is there any advice that you've got for our listeners, you know, that could help them, you know, give a strong performance when being interviewed by multiple people?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it is slightly different when you're not in front of them, because I think what I find interesting about video conferencing is that when I'm in a room with people and there's a panel, I try and make sure that I keep an eye contact with all of them and they can see that I'm keeping eye contact with them. On a video conference, you don't know, because on my display, you know, certain people are in certain places, but you don't know if that's, you know, so you can't look at them in that way. What you need to do is very much look at the camera. That's the most important thing, is look at the camera. But the way that I would go around that is, first of all, preparation. Absolutely research everyone that was going to be on the panel so that I recognized them by name. So I knew what they would look like and I'd memorize their name, so that if they asked me a question, what I would do is reiterate their name when I was responding. So I can't look at them, because I think when you're in front of somebody, you look at them to show you recognize them. You can't do that on a video conference. So you have to, I would say their name, that you'd recognized it was them. It would be flattering anyway, but I think it's good to do that. And I also think by reiterating points or questions that people have made earlier, it reaffirms you'd listened to them in a panel. So in some ways, actually, I think that video conferencing actually makes it less intimidating, because I think we're all quite used to seeing so many little faces now on a screen that it's sort of taken away that, you know, you're on one side of the desk, I'm on the other, there's a barrier. I think that's the great thing about what we're all learning about this, is actually barriers have come down. So I think, look, there's a positive to this, but I do think, do your prep, know what they look like, you know, make sure you use their name when you're responding, so they know, even if you're not looking at them, they know that you're listening to them.
I suppose, a good question to nearly finish off with would be, how can listeners leave a strong, lasting impression with an interviewer?
So I always think myself that asking a question back to them is always personally the best way, because it shows you're genuinely interested. And I think actually I would ask them questions to do with the situation we're in, because as I said right at the start of this podcast, I truly believe that when social historians look back at this time, that they will view this as one of the biggest changes to work that have occurred, you know, in 70 years. So I think I would ask questions around that to this organization. I would ask something like, you know, how do you feel the shape of your organization has changed since this has happened? You know, what have you learned about yourselves? Has this changed your feelings towards remote working? Have you noticed any skills that you didn't know your staff had that you've now realized they do? Or alternatively, have you realized any skill shortages that you might have in your current staff? I mean, we can't get away from what's going on. So I would kind of embrace it, but ask them almost reflective questions on how are you as an organization looking to the future? And how are you preparing for that? And therefore, me as a future employee, you know, I'm really interested in how you, what you've learned and what are you doing moving forward? And I think that's a really flattering question, but also takes into account the context of where we are.
Great points on, how the world of work has changed, and that there will be some positive changes, from what has happened. And, in many ways, it's accelerated in a lot of places, hasn't it? I say now for our last question, if there's one piece of advice to help our listeners navigate their careers during this crisis, what would that be?
I guess it kind of builds on what I've just said. So to me, it's using this time to reflect. It's not been what any of us wanted. Let's be clear. It's from a health point of view, it's awful, and it's not what any of us want, but it's happening. And I think for those of us who are at home now and thinking about our careers, you know, we've got less commuting time. And I would be taking time to really think about my career and how has this changed the shape of what I'm looking for now? You know, do I now want more remote working? Or actually, has this taught me that I hate it and I don't want it at all? How has this changed the shape of what I'm looking for now? What have I learned from this? How has this changed the environment and the type of role that I now want? And not really thinking about it. I think we need to really think, not just momentarily think, but really give some thought to that.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Gail. The insights that you provided us with today have been fantastic. And, I'm sure if people do have a video interview coming up, then they're going to find this really useful. So thank you so much for joining us.
Cool. No, thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to this episode of the Hays Worldwide Careers Advice Podcast. If you have found this advice useful, please do leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. At the same time, if you have any questions or suggestions for future podcast episodes, feel free to reach out to us via email at socialmedia@hays.com.